Thank you, sir. So I'll just be starting my talk on divide and conquer. At the outset, I'd like to say none of us have any financial disclosures to any product. As sir has already said, the aim of all nucleotomy techniques is to facilitate the removal of the entire nucleus out of the capsular bag through the rexus while being safe. That's less traumatic to the corneal endothelium with minimum chances of a PC rent. It should be easy to perform and easily reproducible. So divide and conquer is the initial technique that we all use, which we are initially taught while doing phaco. It is less glamorous than the other techniques. However, it is a very safe technique and it's easily reproducible. So the basic steps of this include dividing it into four quadrants. Because it's easy to crack into four quadrants after that, the quadrants can be impaled easily and brought to the center. They're small enough to be delivered through the rexus. If they're hard, you can further chop them. And it's good for most grades of cataract, and it's easy to do for beginners. So the first step is, of course, making a trench properly, which is a central debulking and grooving. So what we do is use the phaco probe. The bulk of the energy is dissipated into the nucleus, far from the endothelium and far from the posterior capsule. So when you're making a trench, what you should do is basically start proximally, make the trench towards the center, rotate it to the other side, make another trench. Eventually, you land up with these four grooves that you have, which you can easily crack later on. So this is just a video demonstrating the same. It's a fairly black cataract in which this is being done. That's to protect the endothelium. If you were to do another technique, it might be the energy would be delivered more anteriorly near the endothelium. So as you can see, the trench is being made deep enough. How to assess the depth of the trench? One, if it's a softer cataract, the red globe becomes brighter. But in harder cataracts, what you can look at is the orientation of the fibers, and I'll come to that. There was a paper published by Dr. Kurian's group from Narayan Netralay, which shows what you should look at in the lens fiber orientation when you're performing these trenches. It's essential to ensure that there's no central island left over when you're trenching, and it should be deep enough. This is the technique of actually cracking the nucleus. You can see it's being separated into two parts. Then you will rotate it further to the other side and separate each quadrant so as to get these four pyramid-shaped areas where you can hold with the phaco probe and pull out each of these for emulsification. So this is a fairly hard, leathery cataract, and you can see that this is being done fairly easily. Now, this is the paper that I was talking about, the lens orientation to look at of the fibers. When you're superficial with your trench, the fibers tend to be transverse. So you know that you're not at enough of a depth to actually initiate the crack or the chop that you're going to do. When you go deeper on, the fibers turn longitudinal. When you get that orientation, you know that you're at the depth which is required for actually cracking or chopping the nucleus. Following this, it is important to engage each quadrant. So you have to lift up these quadrants. One way is to tap down on the posterior part near the capsule, the rexus margin, and that tends to lift up the piece. It's not playing forward. Yeah, so this is basically just an animation of showing how different types of techniques are there to lift up the apex of the nucleus. One is to tap towards the posterior part of the piece. The other is to go underneath the apex of the piece and lift it up. Sorry, the animation doesn't seem to be playing. I think there's some issue with the laptop, so we'll.
You want to go with the second talk?
We can finish off this. I think the laptop is hung, sir. I'll have to just fix it.
Meanwhile, if anybody has any question or to point to be discussed. Okay, Rushar, ready? Okay,
yes.
Good.
So this is just an animation showing the same, and then this was the last video that I wanted to demonstrate where, again, each piece is pulled out of the Rexis margin and then emulsified. You can go to the equator of the piece once it's out and actually further sub-chop it as well in the at the pupillary plane. So to conclude, it's a safe, effective, and easy technique, and it doesn't require us to be ambidextrous. That's why it's an easy technique for a beginner. Thank you. So the next topic I'll be talking on is on posterior polar cataracts. Now, what is the problem with this? It's associated with a PC weakness or defect. The plaque could be adherent. If you get these white spots adjacent to the onion ring, that's a sure sign of dehiscence of the capsule. There's a high risk of PC rupture in these cases. So basic management includes that the removal should be delayed till there is visually significant handicap because of the cataract. The patient should be informed before surgery of the possibility of a PC rupture and vitreous loss, and also inform them of the varied sites that you might have to use for fixating the IOL. Like Ikeda already pointed out, in cases with nucleus sclerosis, it's a little more tricky. You can't even do a hydrodelineation, so the possibility of a nucleus drop VR intervention should be explained to the patient as well. Hydrodissection should not be attempted because it can rupture the PC. In terms of hydrodelineation, you can inject into the substance of the nucleus, and this thick epinucleus protects the PC during the phacoemulsification. Rotation should also be attempted very, very carefully. Try to avoid rotation as far as possible in these cases. The type of nucleus removal technique should be such to avoid stress to the capsular bag, create a central trench, and then followed by cracking gently without any vigorous maneuvers. And the nucleus fragment should be removed by chopping and stuffing in a slow and controlled manner. Ikeda already demonstrated a visco dissection of the nuclear fragments, which is also helpful. Avoid chamber fluctuations, inject viscoelastic whenever you're withdrawing the phaco probe, and keep the flow rate, the vacuum, and the bottle height lower at these stages. The epinucleus should be removed at the end, separating it from all the corners, and then at the last minute pulling the central part, so in case there is a rupture, it's a small rent. And the cortex removal should be done by bimanual irrigation and aspiration at a low flow and vacuum, and the sub-incisional cortex should be removed slowly as well. This is a video of a posterior polar cataract in which... Okay, so again, the video is not playing, but basically, again, we have to create a trench in the center, then crack this very gently, and then pull out each piece in a well-demarcated manner. Now, femto has also been proposed to be used in posterior polar cataracts, basically because, again, you do not need to use hydrodissection. The femto itself performs a delineation. This has been described by Dr. Vasavada's group, where they used a cylindrical pattern in three different cylinders, and then you pull out each cylinder individually, leaving an epinucleus plate which you pull out at the end. This was a video of flax in a posterior polar. Again, it doesn't seem to be playing. So I'm sorry, I don't think the video seems to be playing. Thank you.